Maybe Joshua learned from walking with Moses the dangers and warning signs of spiritual fatigue. So now we're going to go into some biblical examples. The dangers of burnout: frustration and anger leads to unbelief, disobedience, and rebellion. This allows an entrance for the old man to rise. So, Moses and Aaron, anger, frustration, and unbelief. Moses has gracefully led the rebellious Israelites, even interceding for them after the golden calf debacle, and has had enough. They have reached the desert of Zin and there is no water, so the people start to complain and quarrel against Moses, even daring to ask why he brought them out of Egypt. So Numbers 21 to 12. Then came the children of Israel, even the whole congregation, into the desert of Zin in the first month, and the people abode in Kadesh, and Miriam died there and was buried there. And there was no water for the congregation, and they gathered themselves together against Moses and Aaron. And the people showed Moses and spoke, saying, "Would God that we had died when our brethren died before the Lord. And why have ye brought up the congregation of the Lord into this wilderness, that we and our cattle should die there? And wherefore have ye made us come up out of Egypt to bring us into this evil place? It is no place of seed or figs or vines or of pomegranates, neither is there any water to drink." And Moses and Aaron went from the presence of the assembly unto the door of the tabernacle of the congregation, and they fell on their faces, and the glory of the Lord appeared unto them. Stick a pin there. Let the record show Moses and Aaron's initial response was correct. They did not respond in haste or in their flesh. They went straight into seeking the presence of God. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, "Take the rod and gather thou the assembly together, thou and Aaron thy brother, and speak ye unto the rock before their eyes, and it shall give forth his water, and thou shalt bring forth to them water out of the rock. So thou shalt give the congregation and their beasts drink." And Moses took the rod from before the Lord, as he commanded him. And Moses and Aaron gathered the congregation together before the rock, and he said unto them, "Hear now, ye rebels, must we fetch ye water out of this rock?" And Moses lifted up his hand and his rod, and he smote the rock twice, and the water came out abundantly, and the congregation drank, and their beasts also. The Lord spake unto Moses and Aaron, "Because ye believed me not to sanctify me in the eyes of the children of Israel, therefore ye shall not bring this congregation into the land which I have given them." The sin of Moses and Aaron, how anger led to unbelief and disobedience. And the Lord spake unto Moses and Aaron, "Because ye have believed me not to sanctify me in the eyes of the children of Israel." So it is certain from the text that unbelief was their sin. They were unsure about the willingness of God to bring water out of the rock for such a rebellious people. And they did not put them in mind of the miracles God had wrought in former time to encourage their faith. "Must we fetch you water out of the rock?" which is what they said. And so the Lord was not sanctified them before the people as he ought to have been. So Psalms 106, 32 and 33 says, "They angered him also at the waters of strife, so that it went ill with Moses for their sakes, because they provoked his spirit, so that he spake unadvisedly with our lips." How many of us have had our spirits provoked? I know I provoke some people on this call all the time. "When ye have poured out everything and you keep going..." No, don't be putting your thumb up, Cheryl. Thank you. "When you have poured out everything and keep going, you will only pour out bitterness." So this is what they said. "Hear now, ye rebels, must we fetch you water out the rock?" Now, in the context, we would think, what's wrong with that? They were rebels. So was they rebels? Yes, they was, absolutely. But was Moses and Aaron fetching water out of the rock for them? No. It was God who was bringing the water. And God commanded them to speak to the rock, not the people. Now, the scariest thing about this incident is that Moses and Aaron did this having come out of the presence of God, having waited on God, and having received specific instructions. They still disobeyed God. Imagine that. They went to God, The Bible said they went on their face until the glory came and God spoke to them. They got instruction, but they were still mad because they were probably contemplating, look how long we've been going around with these people. Haven't they seen what God has done for them, brought them out of Egypt, all the things we've done. And now they're winding us up. Why are you bringing us out of Egypt? So even though God has told them what to do, they haven't believed God. They're like, you know what? God is never, ever going to give water to these rebellious people. Surely he's going to let some of them die. No. God told them what to do. They didn't do it. And having received those instructions, they disobeyed God. And this is why James 1 verse 20 says, for the resentful, deep-seated anger or the wrath of a man does not produce the righteousness of God. It is better to say nothing and to fix your relationship with God, deal with all the frustrations, hurts and pains and anger, ask for healing and wisdom, restore your spiritual health, than to try to minister to others and suffer the severe consequences of not fulfilling your duty in a way that glorifies God. We must make sure, and we are all ministers of reconciliation, because we've been given the word of reconciliation and the ministry, that we must be careful that when we are speaking to others on behalf of God, that we are in the correct place with God. Because if we misrepresent God, we might suffer some severe consequences. And if we are coming from a place of anger or bitterness, we can do much harm. As we saw, it went ill with Moses because they angered his spirit. We can't work for God if we're angry. There was one of the prophets that they had to play some music so he could get into the right frame of mind, the right spirit before he delivered the word. We have to make sure that we are like that as well. We don't want to misrepresent God. I believe that this moment of madness by Moses and Aaron was caused by their spiritual fatigue, which led to anger, frustration, and unbelief. This is no criticism on our spiritual ancestors. Not only was the task Moses had unique and unlike any other taken on, save that of Jesus himself, mediator of the covenants, and if you read Deuteronomy 34 verse 10, that will give you confirmation that Moses was unlike any other. He and Aaron did not have the benefits of the new covenant. So, you know, they did not have the indwelling Holy Spirit. This is before the better covenant and better promises. This is a whole different era. So this is not a criticism of them. You know, it's understandable, but thank God that grace covers all our failures. And we know that in this war, we are going to take some hits. In transition, it's likely that we're going to have to go around the same place of failure a few times. And actually, we're going to see when we get into Joshua chapter 2 that God loves to give us victory in previous places of defeat. But that's for next week. But thank God that grace covers all failures. That, look, when we do make a mistake, because we are human and because we are weak and because we are in flesh, God gives us the opportunity to make it up. Now, Moses didn't get into the promised land physically, but he got into the promised land. So God speaks to us in all states of our being. Anger and joy, frustration and peace, confusion and contentment. He speaks in diverse ways too. Sometimes he speaks in silence. That's a Bible study in itself. But in being ministers of God, who he has graciously given the ministry and word of reconciliation, all that we do with God must be born out of our relationship with him. The secret place is where we receive our anointing and grace to do, in our victories birthed out of relationship with God through Christ. For it is God who worketh in us both to will and to do his good pleasure. God speaks to us all the time. Doesn't matter how we're feeling, he's always speaking, right? We have to sometimes go somewhere, be quiet and listen. But we have to understand that everything we do for God has to come from a relationship with God. Otherwise, it's false. We must be in right relationship with God. And from there, we receive the oil and the wine to pour into others. The Bible says he's the God of all comfort, who comforts us so that we can comfort others. If we're not getting comforted by God, how can we comfort others? If we don't have the comforter indwelling with us, we have no encouragement for anyone else. Sometimes you have to take some time out to fix you. You can't be worrying about someone else and you're a mess. And I know women especially who have that nurturing nature, it's in your nature to put other people before you. But no, sometimes you need to say, no, I need to fix me and God, because guess what? It's not going to be an excuse that you was fixing the world and didn't make it in because you, God wasn't even dealing with you. You don't want to be one of those people that God says, you did do all this in my name. Focus on fixing you first. And then now you are in right standing. And as we talked about Zadaka, and then you can start dishing out social justice. Your most important relationship is between you and God. You can't love anyone else, right? Unless you love him, right? We have to get that in our heads. Stop trying to deal with others before you deal with yourself. It's the primary basis of everything. Love the Lord, your God, with all your heart, soul, and mind. First commandment. And the second is like unto this, the great commandment, that you love your neighbor as yourself. But that comes from the first commandment. I can't keep banging that home hard enough. Right.